Amen. If you have your Bible, turn with me this morning. John chapter 1. The Gospel according to John chapter 1. Listen, Wednesday night, Miss Ann's class is going to have a little party at 5:30. Let me speak this. We have confusion because everything is going on at one time. And in the name of Jesus, I bind that confusion out.
Amen.
I don't do no play practice. I don't do no Christmas program. I'm going to tell you something. A Christmas program with confusion ain't nothing. It's the devil's tool. I can't stand it. So in the name of Jesus, devil, you don't have no right, no privilege in our children. You don't have no right, no privilege in the program that we have put together to glorify the Son of God. So Lord, you take control. Help us, Lord, help us. The title this morning is, Where's the Lamb? We spoke last week about where's the Lamb. We found the Lamb that God had provided with his head in a thicket for Abraham. And God made a way. He called that place that God is my provider. This morning we're going to look in John chapter 1. And we're going to look and begin in verse 29. It says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man, which is preferred before me, and he was before me, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptized with water. John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him, and I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water. The same said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining upon him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again, the next day after John stood unto his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, Behold the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following him. He said unto them, What do you seek? What do you want? And they said unto him, Rabbi, which is to say, being interpreted, Master, where dwellest thou? Where do you stay? Where do you stay, Master? And I'm going to read just a piece of 39. And he said unto them, Come and see. Come and see. See, where's the Lamb? Where's the Lamb? Many times we speak or we think ourselves, or ask him, say, God, where are you? Where was you? God, where was you? How could this happen? How could this be? God didn't show himself. He didn't do what I thought he should have done. And some people think that to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus means that you go to heaven. I've heard people say a lot of times, especially at funerals, and it was just over a year ago we buried my sweet grandmother, and I know without a doubt that she's in heaven because of her profession of faith, the trust that I've seen her living her life in Christ Jesus. But what I'm saying is, a lot of times when people die, we'll draw comfort from saying, well, now they have help. Now they have healing. Now they have heaven. Now they're in the presence of God. And those things are true. I don't want to refute that in any way today. But to have a relationship with Jesus, to find the Lamb, it's more than just going to heaven. Understand that heaven is a better place. Understand that to be in the presence of God is what you want. But we don't have to die to know God. Get that out of your mind. We don't have to wait till we die for God to help us. We don't have to wait till we die to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, if we think that way, if you just gave your life to Christ just so you go to heaven, I'm telling you, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. You won't make it. We got to have the Lord. We got to find the Lamb. We got to have Him. It's, you know, we can receive comfort today. Amen. We need help today. We need to be in the presence of the Lord today. I feel bad for folks that's been in church all their life and they never felt it, been in the presence of the Lord. I feel bad for folks that had never humbled themselves and not been in a hurry to get the last piece of chicken down at Betty's and was able to lay there for a minute and then let the Lord minister to them. Yeah. You can be in the presence of the Lord today. You can have help today. And that's what we want. Listen, Jesus is the King of Heaven. He is the king of heaven, but you know what? He's also the head of the church. He's the commander-in-chief. So how could you have a commander-in-chief that's only in heaven that don't have nothing to do with us, that don't care about it? That's not the truth. So when we hear, I can go to heaven. Yeah, praise the Lord, we get to go to heaven. I thank the Lord for God's church. I thank the Lord that God meets us where we're at. I thank the Lord that he sent his son here to this earth so we could have a lamb, the Lamb of God. And we would have to be careful to try to compare heaven to the church, because the church is full of sinners. Amen? Listen, you know what the Bible says is in the church? The Bible says there are sheep and goats. Amen? You ever notice that? The Bible tells us that in the church that there's sheep and goats. And it also says that in the church, in the field, that there's wheat and tares. And you know what? The angel said, well, Master, do you want me to go get them out? He said, no. He said, let them grow together. Let them grow together unless you uproot one with the other. He said, but one day when he comes, when it's all said and done, when we get to heaven, he said, I'll pull them out, and the bad will throw in the fire, and the other will be in the glory of God. But when we go to church, it's both there. And the thing about it is that sometimes the sheep feed off the goats. And sometimes the wheat will look like tares. Don't compare church to heaven. Now, it's to come. There's some similarities. But you know, I get sick and tired of people saying, well, a bunch of hypocrites, bunch of this, bunch of that. Listen, what are you talking about? We will never get over our sicknesses and our weaknesses and our hang-ups separate from Christ. And the church, the ones of you today that's born again, you are the body of Christ. You're the church. You're the church. This baseline. We haven't get started. So when you call a hypocrite and when you call a liar and other things, you know, sometimes those accusations are right. Is there anybody in here that's born again that ain't never done something hypocritical? Lift your hand, let me see. All right. That leads me to the next one. Do we have any liars? Yeah. And so when we can't only look for the Lamb in heaven. The Lamb doesn't just hang out in heaven, and the Lamb doesn't just hang out at the church. And the Lamb isn't just what we think in this box that we built. He is an all-consuming God. He's there in you. Listen, he's at your house if you let him. Yeah. He said, well, I don't want him in my house. He wouldn't approve of that. Well, you better. Huh? What are you going to do when you get in trouble when you're home? What are you going to do when you don't know what to say to your kids? What are you going to do when something bad happens? What are you going to do? He's all-consuming. He's in our homes. He's there when you wake up in the morning. He's not restricted to the church or to the people who want him. He's the Savior of this world. God sent him as a gift and a payment for the sin of this world. And I'm glad people come to church to seek out the Savior. But we need to look for him in our bedrooms. We need to look for him in the morning time around the breakfast table. He's the answer to your day. Amen. And he's available to be your everything. I was thinking about this song this morning about how, I wish I could sing it, but I'm not going to try to. This song says, some have made Jesus a game that they play. To others, he's the last thought in mind. A song that they sing. Is Jesus just a song you sing? But since I met Jesus, I'm happy to say, to me, he's become everything. Well, to me, he's become everything. He's everything that I need. He's the beginning and the end. He's life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. Well, when I wake up each morning, he's right by my side. At night, he's my last thought in mind. You see, he's joy for each morning. Hope that faith brings to me, he's become everything. Well, to me, he's become everything.
Thank you, Lord.
He's everything that I what somebody else is doing. It ain't the truth, church. Don't tell me that Jesus is over everything and then go off and be mad at sister so-and-so and such, and I don't understand, and I just don't get it why such and such said that. Call the preacher a hypocrite, call the demon. Don't go off and tell me Jesus over everything and do that depending upon your demons. See, yes, God has placed some in the body as pastors and evangelists and deacons and teachers and prayer warriors. He's placed some in the body. But he gives you Jesus for the sum total of all of it. I hope you're recording this.
Amen.
Somebody needs to hear this word. Amen. Listen. John was doing his thing. He was baptizing, he was answering questions, he was preaching, eating locusts and honey, praise the Lord, and he looked up and he said, well, well, behold the Lamb of God. There he is, that's the one I've been looking for. That's the operation of God right in front of me. He comes walking up there, they had a conversation, and then we're not preaching on that, but we need to start watching for him instead of watching out for ourselves. People have our eye on everything in this world. We're worried about what someone else has got, what somebody else said. We're worried about what they're doing. Listen, you know what? Facebook is a murderer. And we get to worry about what everybody in this world is doing. Everything. What you're eating, what you're wearing, what you're planning, when your party is, when you're going on vacation, what you're doing at the beach. We worry about what everybody's doing. Except what God's doing. Then we start stirring up envy. It starts stirring up grief. It starts stirring up sorrow. I don't know why they're so happy. I'm so sad. I don't know why they get to go on vacation. I don't get to go on vacation. I know it's the truth. You look sad about it. I told you that, but you know it's the truth. All of that stuff has become our guide. That information overload has become who we want to be. Tell you something. That path is rough. That path is rough. Jesus is currently working and moving and has made himself available. And we have to recognize that. We have to follow that. And we have to allow him to be everything. We're going to go on down, but in verse 37 it says that two of these disciples heard him. They heard him speak. When John said, oh, there's the Lamb of God, and he's looking, he said, oh, look, there's the Lamb of God. Two of those disciples heard that. They said, where? They saw him walking. They saw him working. They saw him moving. And they began to follow him. The Bible says in verse 37, the two disciples heard him speak, but they followed him. And so that they had to go, stop what they were doing. They had to change, quit looking what everybody else is doing. They made a conscious decision. Somebody get this, because you can do this morning. You can do this before you leave here. They made a conscious decision to stop what they were doing and follow him. Now, I know for years, can I just... I wish I had preached. That's what it means to be saved. I tell you what, when I was 10 years old and I prayed a prayer and the preacher patted me on the head and I got baptized, and I was, thank you, Lord, my mom was happy, I was happy, and I believe that God entered into my heart. I believe that he sealed me for the day. Amen. But listen. Nobody tell me, well, listen, the rest of that story, you need to follow him. Yeah. You got to stop what you're doing. Follow him, son. I followed whatever kid in the school was doing. I followed whatever was on TV, whatever song I liked. I followed whatever girl I was chasing, whatever tasted good, smoked good, smelled good, made me feel good. That's what I went after. I didn't follow Jesus. If there was something to argue about, something to fight about, something to take, just whatever. And then I knew following Jesus, and then this is as boldly as I could think in myself. Oh, I'm saved. You know what it means to be saved? It's to stop what you're doing. Repent. Repent. Follow the Lord. They made a conscious decision to stop what they were doing, what they were feeling, what they were thinking, and to follow Him. And I don't know how far they went. I don't know how many steps they went. I don't even know what direction they was heading. But after just a little bit, Jesus took notice of that. Will you open this? After just a minute, Jesus took notice and He stopped. He turned around and He said, "What y'all want?" You say, "Well, God, don't listen. Yeah, the Lord come after you this morning, but don't be surprised when He asks you something like, what do you want? What are you following me for? What'd you come to church for? What do you want?" Can I tell you something, folks in this house this morning? You didn't come here because you wanted Jesus. I don't know who you are. You may not know who you are. But there's folks in this house this morning. They're here because they come wanting Jesus. I promise you. This is what it is. Why are you following me? What do you want? He took notice. He said, "What did you seek? What are you looking for? Tell me, listen, tell me your heart on why you're following me. Tell me your heart why you're following me." And they began, if he asked me that, I'd begin to stutter and stammer, you know. But they said, "Master, Rabbi, Master, listen, we want to know where you live at. Where dwellest thou?" says King James. "We want to know where you live at. We want to know where you stay at. We want to know where you're at, what you're calling your home, your abode. We want to know where you're at." Now, some fellow gets behind me in the center, and I stop and say, "Hey, man, what do you want?" He said, "I don't know where you live. I ain't telling him. I ain't fixing to tell him." But that was their heart. Their heart wanted to know. They could have asked him anything. They said, "Hey, can I have a few bucks?" "Yeah. You think that you can just speak something good? Hey, can you pray for me? My sister's sick, and I need you to pray for me. Can you pray?" They could have asked him for anything. He asked, he said, "Where do you stay? Where do you live? Not can you get us some, or will you help me, or I need something. But where are you going to be staying? Because that's where I want to be. I want to know where you're going to be staying at, Lord, because that's where I'm going. I want to know where you spend your time because I want to move my stuff to where you're at, and I'll just leave whatever you don't want me to have. I'll leave it there." They didn't just want a glimpse of Him passing by. They didn't want to just talk about it. They didn't want to hear about it on Facebook. They didn't want to wait till it met the newspaper. They wanted to talk to Him and know Him and be in the middle of Him. They wanted to know how to follow Him, and when they come time, they needed to know how to reach Him. I've been in places in my life before where I was so far away from God, I didn't know how to find Him. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know where to go. They made provision for that. They didn't want a glimpse. They wanted to know where He lived. And I believe they would have moved in with Him, huh? But let me tell you how this thing works today. If you just want to move into Him later, but the problem is we need to let Him move in with us. It sounds like a play on word, but it means everything. God, I want you to do this. God, I need you to do this. God, would you please come in? God, would you please help me? Would you answer this? Would you provide this? And what He wants is for you just let Him move in and take care of all of it. I'll make room for you. Oh, I need to clean that stuff up. Okay, I'll get rid of it. Well, what's going on in your heart? I mean, can you imagine sitting down at night instead of watching the Chicago PD or whatever, Fear Factor, whatever you watch? Can you imagine sitting down on the couch and having a conversation with Jesus about what's in your heart? Like you're sitting around a campfire. What's going on? What's going on in your heart? Well, you know what? I got really frustrated this morning because so-and-so said this. And I said, okay, well, listen, son, that's right. You know, they probably didn't mean it. You don't know what was going on in their life, but what's going on in your heart? Oh! Can we just watch a couple of PD? Can we talk about something else? Ask him and invite him to move in with us. Don't just take a peek on Sunday morning. Look for him when you're broke. Don't just look for him when you're hurting. But make a place. Make a place. Better yet, give him your place. Give him your place. Now understand, Jesus won't force you into nothing. I've heard people preach that kind of stuff. It's not the truth. Jesus won't force anyone. He only invites us. He only invites us. He invites us to trust Him. He invites us to follow Him. He invites us to live for Him. If that's your decision. Some people say, when God dealt with me, it wasn't nothing I can do. Listen, that's called irresistible grace. It's a lie. God don't force nothing on nobody. We got some tulips in here, I'm sorry, but I'm telling you, I ain't never seen it. But you know what He does? He invites us. Please come. Would you come? Would you let me? I'm here. It's all available. And that's our decision. Nothing hindering us this morning in God's eyes except us. Because here's what we say, this is what we worry about. Well, I don't know how, and I can't figure out, and if I did, and if I give my life to Christ, if I started following Christ, I don't know what happened to my friends. If I got out of this kind of work, I couldn't pay my bills. I'm just going to do this for a little while until God does something else, blah, blah. Listen, He's not interested in all that. He wants you. Seek ye first the kingdom, getting all these things to be added unto you. That's simple. It's hard to do. You can't work it out. You can't figure it out. Well, what if I lose this? Or what if that? What if this happens? What if my wife leaves me? What if my kids laugh? All this stuff. Listen. He finished it up on the cross, and He sealed the deal when He rose from the grave. I promise you, every scenario that's come up in every man's life on this planet since that day has been covered. It's been dealt with. You see, God sent the Lamb. The Lamb was slaughtered. And then He rose Him back from the dead. It's the highest thing ever fell upon a man's ear. There's nothing greater. There's nothing more impossible. There's nothing that's more powerful. There's nothing that has more influence than that. And it's done. So everything that we got going on in our life and everything that we understand and we hurt and we do, all these things come under that. Every scenario. Because God's Lamb is superior. They didn't know what He would say. They didn't know what He would say when they asked Him, where are you going? Where do you live at? Can you just tell us where we live? But listen. They said, where do you stay? And He said, come and see. He said, Master, Rabbi, where do you stay? Where do you stay? He said, come and see. I'll show you. Come and see where I stay at. He invites them and He invites us to come and see. Come and see what life is like with Him. You can't figure out what life's like with Him. Come and see. You won't regret it. You come and see. By the way, I'm not gonna. It will cost you. You start serving the Lord, it's gonna cost you. I promise. But come and see. God has offered us heaven's best, more than enough, and He'll be with you if you let Him. He's the promise for today. He's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. He's the one that won't leave you nor forsake you. You got some Jesus, you might have a worldly feeling of loneliness, but if you look up, there he is. He ain't left you yet. He's all we need. He's the lamb of our lives. He's an all-sufficient friend. And I want to ask you, do you have that? So when we say, where's the lamb? Do you have that? Do you have that in your life? Real simple to look and see, because if not, just listen to yourself talk. I catch myself all the time. All the time. I said, wait a minute, son. What are you talking about? What are you worried about? What are you hurting about? What do you need? I've got it. This morning, Cole, you come. I don't want to preach too long. This morning, we're going to have a time to pray. We're going to have a time. Listen, I believe this with my heart. You can be saved this morning. You can come and see and leave everything that you think and feel and worry and all this stuff. You can leave that and say and make a condescension. Say, God, I want your son. I'm leaving my stuff and the debt it's caused me. Leaving him to pay for it, and I want him as my friend. I want him as the lover of my soul. I want him to be the one that I look to and trust. You can make a conscious decision to do that today. Or maybe you just need to pray. Ask him to heal you, help you. I don't have anything to impart to you except the name of Jesus Christ. That's it.